Good morning. Welcome to Victoria's Faith. I'm Cherry Campbell. I want to remind you again that this Saturday, November 18 at 6:30 p.m. is our next Victoria's Faith service in North Denver in Thornton. We're meeting again at the Holiday Inn Express and Suites on the northeast corner of 120th Avenue and Grant Street. So go to my website at victoriousfaith.co. Victorious is like a champion, V-I-C-T-O-R-I-O-U-S, faith, F-A-I-T-H, dot C-O, C-O like Colorado. And go to the meeting schedule page there, and you will see the details of time and location and the map for your directions. Come and join us this Saturday, November 18 at 6:30 p.m. in North Denver, in Thornton, at the Holiday Inn Express and Suites. You'll be blessed you came. Glory to God. Now, we are studying the lesson, Proofs That Abundance Is God's Will. Proofs That Abundance Is God's Will. Yesterday, we started proof number 17, and this is the names of God. The names of God are proofs that abundance is God's will. And we are primarily looking at two of his names. And why did I say the names of God? Because the names of God reveal God's nature and character and his works. Because his works come from his nature. Just like we just finished the study of God is good. But with that, his works are good. Psalm 119:68, you are good and what you do is good. You cannot do, if you're a good person, you don't do bad. If you're good, you do good. If you're loving, you do loving. So your works are the reflection of who you are and what you are. So we're looking at the names of God because the names of God identify who God is, his nature and character, and therefore what are his works? What kind of works does he do? And his names are revealed in the scripture, in the Bible, to reveal to us what is God's nature and what kind of works does he do. So we're looking at two of the names of God. And we started with, and we are still on, the first one. Yesterday we mentioned this. The first name we're looking at is Jehovah Jireh. Now in Hebrew it's probably pronounced something more like Yehovah Yireh, but we pronounce it in the American way, Jehovah Jireh. And this is a compound name of God, the first name being Jehovah and the second word being Jireh or Yireh. And so let's look at both of those names. The first name, Yehovah, means the eternal one or and the self-existent one. Eternal, self-existent one. The one who was and is to come. Now there are many different Jehovah compound names in the Bible. You've probably heard of several of them. He is Jehovah Rapha, or sometimes Rophe, and he is also, that means the Lord your healer. And you must believe he is the Lord your healer. He is not the one who was, but he is and is to come your healer. Forever, he never changes. You cannot say healing passed away. There are churches and denominations that have taught healing has passed away. Well, are you saying the eternal one, God, has passed away? You cannot say healing has passed away when he is the healer and he is eternal and he never changes. The one who was and is to come, the one who never changes, the one who reveals himself forever in this, at least as long as we have a physical body. The eternal body won't need healing. The glorified body won't need healing, that is. But this physical earthly body needs healing. And so God has revealed himself, I am your healer. I am your covenant partner. And I mentioned Jehovah is a covenant name of God, revealing his covenant relationship to his people. His covenant relationship to his people. In covenant relationship, he says, because you need to go back to understand covenant. Covenant, blood covenant, was the highest and strongest relationship, and always has been, between two people. And today, people don't recognize it like they did before, and people don't even honor it. As marriage is a blood covenant, but people break that covenant regularly. But in ancient times, especially, a blood covenant was very highly esteemed, not lightly esteemed, not lightly taken. It was highly esteemed, highly regarded, highly honored. It was the strongest relationship between two people. It was an oath or oaths made in blood that could not be broken without penalty of death. And so when somebody made an oath in blood, that was binding without question, without question. And so God, in a blood covenant relationship, both sides would make oaths or promises of commitment to the other. So God was not just expecting us to make promises to him. And a lot of Christians today have the wrong idea that it's one-sided, that we just serve God and we make promises to him and we're going to do this. Do you realize God made promises to us? And he stands by his promises, and all of his promises were and are fulfilled in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And they're eternally settled forever. God has fulfilled his promises to us in Christ. But they are eternal, but they are, God has made promises to man. God has made oaths to man. And he makes his oaths in his names. And Jehovah Rapha, or Rapha, healer, he makes an oath to be your healer. His covenant relationship with you, to you, for you, is your healer. Another one is Jehovah Shalom, your peace. Another one, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Tzidkenu, Jehovah, more and more. They go on and on and on. Your righteousness, your banner, all of these things, your shepherd. Those are his names revealing what he will do for you. Well, Jehovah Jireh is another of those compound covenant names that God has taken for himself, making covenant promise to you. Covenant oath. To you. This is his oath to you, his commitment to you. And so the second word is Jireh or Yireh, and it actually means to see and provide. To see and provide. And I read to you yesterday Genesis 22, where God called Abraham his covenant partner because God had already made a covenant in blood with Abraham. And that was not lightly esteemed. It was strongly, seriously, highly esteemed by Abraham. And so in Genesis 22, God tested Abraham and told Abraham to offer his son Isaac on the altar. Without hesitation, Abraham obeyed. And we read in Hebrews 11, it's because he expected the raising of the dead, the resurrection of the dead. His faith was working for the resurrection of the dead. Then you go on in Genesis 22, when he had laid his son on the altar and raised the knife to slay his son, the angel of the Lord called out to Abraham, calling him, Abraham, Abraham, and then said, do not lay a hand on your boy. Do not do anything to him. For I know you fear God because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. And there is so much meaning in this. I mean, we could spend hours on these verses. There's a lot of prophetic picture here of Jesus Christ being the Son of God and being offered for us on the altar of the cross, but we're not going to go that direction. Then you go on and look in Genesis 22:13. Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket, he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. And verse 14 says, so Abraham called that place, in the Hebrew text, it's written Yehovah Yireh, or Jehovah Jireh. He called that place Jehovah Jireh. And to this day, it is said, on the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. It will be provided. So then I gave you the definition yesterday of Jireh. It means to see and provide. And then I explained to you, if you even take the word provision in English, provision. Pro is a prefix similar to pre, which means beforehand, ahead of time, or in advance. Pre and pro are the same meaning here. To see before, and then vision means sight, or to see, seeing. Provision means literally seeing beforehand, seeing ahead of time. We have another word in English that is a synonym, and it is the word foresight. Foresight. F-O-R-E-S-I-G-H-T. Foresight. What is foresight? Foresight is seeing ahead of time, but you're not just seeing ahead of time something that's coming. If you have foresight, you are also taking action, taking steps to get ready ahead of time for something you see coming. That's foresight. You're not just going to see it and ignore it. You do something about it. You get ready. You take measures in advance. And that's what we were saying yesterday. Measures taken in advance, beforehand. It is getting ready for what you see coming. Getting ready for what you see coming. Getting ready for what you see coming. So you don't only see it and do nothing about it. You see it and get ready. I gave the example, if you are preparing a Thanksgiving dinner, getting ready, maybe you've got people going to come join you for dinner Thanksgiving Day. Then what are you going to do? Well, you have to start with a menu. You make your menu. And then you have to go to the grocery store and buy the ingredients for your menu. You might also need to clean house, do other things to what? Get ready. So you are taking steps in advance beforehand for what you see coming. That is provision, also prevision. Doing something about what you see coming. Well, God's name, Jehovah Jireh, is his covenant oath and promise to you that he sees ahead of time. He sees the future. He knows the future. He sees what's coming. And he makes preparations ready in advance. He is taking he takes measures beforehand in advance. And it also means to make previous and prior arrangements in advance for the supply of a need, for the supply of a need. So God sees your tomorrow and your next week and your next month and your next year. And God has already taken steps in advance to make provision, to make supply ready for what is coming, to make supply ready ahead of time for what is coming. And God has specifically done it for his covenant people because it's his covenant oath, his promise to his people, I'm taking care of you. I see ahead of time. I see the future better than you know the past. I see the future. I see and know what's coming. And I have already taken measures and steps and action to make provision for it, to supply, to lay up and make ready all that you will need before it comes. It's already there. It's laid up. It's ready. It's prepared for you. There are so many scriptures as I'm even saying this that just pop in my mind that he lays up, he prepares ahead of time. So many scriptures, preparation in advance for us. Yesterday, I was giving you some scriptures about, I love it in the King James translation using the words, the foundation of the world. And some scriptures say from the foundation of the world. Others say before the foundation of the world. So whether it's from the foundation of the world or before the foundation of the world, what we see is God has already laid up everything you will ever need before the foundation of the world, before the world began, before there was an earth. God had already made preparations for you. Before there was mankind, God already made preparations for you. And certainly before you were born, God has already made preparations for you, for every day of your life, every minute of every day, for everything you will ever need. God has made a supply ready and stored up, ready and waiting for you, for all your needs. Glory to God. Matthew 25, we were looking at yesterday, and verse 34. And the king says to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. You see, God prepared the kingdom for you from the foundation of the world. Glory to God. From the foundation of the world, he prepared his kingdom. Well, the kingdom, as we taught in this series, the kingdom of God is everything God has. The kingdom of God is everything God has. Everything he owns, it's his territory. And it's everything that he owns in his territory. It's all of his real estate and all of his, what he has and owns in his territory of dominion. And he has made it and prepared it for you, for you, for you, from the foundation of the world. So anything and everything God has, it's in his kingdom. And it's for you, prepared for you from the foundation of the world. You can get anything and everything you need from God that has been, and it is already ready for you. Praise the Lord. Ephesians 1:4 says, he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. So before there was a world, before there was any mankind, God had a plan in his heart, and it was you and me, and he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Glory to God. You were chosen to be in him before the foundation of the world. Hebrews 4:3 says the works were finished. His works were finished from the foundation of the world. It says, let me read it again. Yet his work has been finished from the foundation of the world. His works have been finished from the foundation of the world. That means all of his works, everything he had to do for you and to get ready for you, were finished before the foundation of the world. Now, your mind probably has a hard time grasping and understanding that, because, and your mind might go tilt trying to think about how could God have done all of his works before the foundation of the world. It's because God lives in the timeless realm. We live in a realm ruled by time, and it's hard when you're in time to understand what it's like outside of time. But God is already in the future as much as he's in our past, because in him there is no time. He is in the timeless realm. So that means in him and in his timeless realm, everything you are ever going to do and any provision he would make for that, he did already before you see it happening, because he is outside of time. We are in time, but he is outside of time. He is in the timeless realm. Like I said, he is already in the future. He's in the future right now, as much as he is in the past, because he is in the timeless realm. And so as best I can explain that, we still, you know, can't fully understand, but that helps you, I hope, to get a picture of how God is already in your future. He's already there. He's not going to show up when you get there. He's already there. God is already in your future. And let's bring it closer to home. God is already in your today. Today. And he was here in today before you got here. You get that? He was here in today. Your today. Before you got here. And before you got here today, God was already here today. And God already got ready everything you needed for today before you got here today. It is awesome to think about, if you can. God was already here today, in today, before you got here today. God knew everything that was going to happen today, and God already made preparation in advance, and God got everything ready. Just like you might be getting ready for Thanksgiving Day and Thanksgiving dinner, and people who are going to come, perhaps, to join you for Thanksgiving dinner, and you are already getting things ready before they come. Well, guess what? God is already in your today, and he was here today before you got here today, and he made ready for your today before you got here today. And so everything you need today is already done. God finished it before you got here. God finished it before you got here. So today's needs are already done, finished, provided for, laid up, ready, accomplished. Glory to God. And so everything you need today, God has already finished and made ready in advance for you, because he was here today before you got here today. Glory, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Now let's look at 1 Peter 1, 19 and 20. You are redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world. So we're redeemed by the precious lamb, blood of Christ, the lamb foreordained before the foundation of the world. And then in Revelation, you connect that verse to Revelation 13:8, and it says, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So he was foreordained and he was slain from the foundation of the world. So before there was a world and before there was mankind, Jesus was already slain before there was a world to be slain in and before there was man to be slain for, to be the redeemer for. Jesus was already slain from the foundation of the world. So through Jesus Christ, God made provision for you, seeing ahead of time, for all your needs. All your needs. Let me remind you, go to Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus, or in Christ Jesus, some scriptures say. He shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory, or his glorious riches, by Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus. He supplies all your need because he has already done it. He has already supplied for all your needs. Glory to God. I'm out of time. Join us Saturday in Thornton. Join me tomorrow. Remember, God loves you. You're blessed and highly favored by the Lord.